Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you for joining us on webinar for March, just before Shahr Ramadan. So thanks everybody who has joined us. We have a very special guest, as you know, a lot of you have signed up. But before we start, just like to for perhaps people who are new and they're joining in for the first time, have a little bit of an introduction before we start, inshallah.
Inshallah.
So, inshallah, hopefully you can see. So hopefully you can see that. So as we normally start the webinars, we start with reflection on the Quran, and for today I wanted to look at the concept of touch in the Quran and what it really, how the Quran uses touch. So the first verse we see here is Surah Ali Imran, and it's Mary or Lady Maryam who is speaking here, where she says, "Qalat Rabbi inni yakunu lihi walad, walam yumassihi bashar." She said, "My Lord, how can I have a child when no human has touched me?" Right, and this is where touch is being used as a sexual connotation. We see this as a sexual reference to the word touch here. Later on, we find in chapter 20, in the case of Samari and in the case of the golden calf, when Moses goes back and he finds them worshiping the golden calf, and he finds Samari, says, "Kala fazhab fa'inna laka fil hawat an yukulu lamasas." He said, "Be gone, for indeed in your lot in this life is to say, no touching, la misas, no touch for you." Now, this Quranic term, la misas, some scholars say that this is used in the sense to be involved in a disease where nobody could actually touch Samari. So he got an infliction of a physical disease in which he had to be away from people. And this is a punishment which was given. And it's really interesting that in you know, being deprived of touch, what is for Samari is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That, and the word is very clear. It says, lamisas, and the fact that no touching here in this context is talking about the punishment in this case. So we can see how important touch is, and if God takes that away, and then that becomes as the punishment. Now, there's sometimes where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses it more metaphorically. So we find in chapter 70, and there's a number of verses here, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when touched by adversity, this person is impatient, or when touched by good, he is ungenerous. So over here, touch is, a touch could be a good touch, you know, or good, or could be something which is unhealthy, but also metaphorically, if we're touched by something, if something happens to us, touched by adversity, as we say metaphorically. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for this individual, there is an exception. There's an exception to these people who, even if they got, even if they're touched by adversity or touched by good al-khair, if they are al-musallin, if they're prayerful, hum ala salatihim da'imun, who are constant, not just people who are praying, people who are constant in their prayer. والذين في أموالهم حق معلوم. And who know that in their wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, there is an appointed share, an acknowledged share, for who? The person who asks, لِسَائِلٍ وَالْمَرْهُومِ. And it's really interesting when we look at this in the concept of counseling, in the concept of people who are deprived. We can clearly say at the moment people are deprived from the counseling of same-sex attraction, or the counseling of some people are deprived of this at the moment because this is something which isn't available. Moving on a few more verses, God continues to say, in the exception, there are people who protect their private parts. So we see how it starts from the touching of adversity or the touching of good. And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about sexual morality. We know, إِلَّا الْمُسَلُّونَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Salah keeps you away from fahisha wal munkar, right? So Salah, our prayer, has the ability to keep us away from sexual immorality. Now this is continued where he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ, they preserve, they protect their private parts, they protect their chastity. إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ, obviously, again, not for, if we're married, for our spouses. And then God again reminds on sexual morality, فَمَنْ إِبْتَغَىٰ, but whoever seeks to go beyond that, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْآدُونَ, الْآدُونَ, which is again referred to those of you know from the story of Lut alayhi salam, common adun. So it's interesting how in the Quran we find this concept of sexual morality, having prayer, and how that's connected to touch. So hopefully there's so much more in this chapter that for the brevity, we cannot go forward, but I encourage you to look further if you are interested. Now, in terms of people who are new to Strong Support, we are a peer support organization for Muslims who struggle with sexual identity. We are recently also expanding our services for people who struggle with gender identity as well. We have a free consultation, 30 minutes call. I actually take these. So we've had over 200 calls since we started with people around the globe on this issue. We do weekly support circles for men, women, parents, and spouses. And also, there was such a huge demand for a resource in Arabic. So we have a special group, which is for Arab speakers as well. We also do one-to-one coaching, and our webinars like this is always free because it's so important that we get the ummah to understand this issue more, and it becomes less of a taboo or less of a difficult topic to address. Now, this is really difficult for me to introduce Richard because to put it bluntly, for me, I would say the pioneers in this work, for me, and you know, this is very selfishly, I'm talking about myself, were Joseph Nicolosi and Richard Cohen. And for every client that comes to us, we say, we just use those names, literally. So I read Coming Out Straight at a time where I was completely lost, and I didn't know, you know, if there was anything there. And I know Richard can comment. I heard on the podcast he did with Wahid Jensen, where he's sat in the North Conference and he's agitated at this person who doesn't give him an answer, saying, "Oh, there isn't any way to out of it. Oh, it's wrong, but we're not going to tell you how to get out of it," right? And the frustration, and I know a lot of people who are finding this work find it really frustrating when there isn't a practical way to address these issues. And what I really admire of Richard is that it wasn't something that he had in his life trajectory to be a psychotherapist. He says that it was something due to his own struggle with same-sex attraction that he felt it was almost like a duty, almost like a calling, which said, no, I need to do something about this. I need to, you know, go back. I know he was an artist manager in Asia at the time, and then he completely changed. He goes back to college school, studies counseling, psychology, and it's really, really admirable. 33 plus 34 years of work in this, training over 6,000 physicians, psychologists, and having huge impact on people's life. Honestly, like I still feel like I'm that little kid in front of Richard when I'm reading my coming out straight book, and I'm thinking, oh my God, this person says he wrote his whole 10 years of struggle in this book. I connected so deeply. And I think one of the ways where we can show how oppressed this population is that we find the people who are helping are the people who've gone through the issue themselves. And you don't find that in other issues. You don't find that in depression. You don't find that in anxiety. You don't find that in other places where it's like, oh, only the people who go through it are now available for that. And it's so much harder. I mean, at least for me, when I'm doing the work, I'm like, okay, this can be triggering. It's triggering some parts of me, but to go beyond and to do that is hugely admirable. We're going to discuss the book, but I wanted to say, I have every single book. you can see here, I've got literally every single book which I could get hold of. And you know what? These are really hard to get a hold of nowadays, especially, they're absolutely practical. And you know what I like about Richard is, Nicolosi for some people can be too clinical. It can be like, oh, okay, I need a degree to understand some of these words. And I think he puts it as like, keep it really simple. And that's straight and simple. And that is exactly what the books talk about. I think the first coming out straight is now called Being Gay, Nature, Nurture, or Both. So it's, and I think it's important that we use language which is in with the time, right? Because as we evolve our understanding of what sexual identity is. We evolve in our understanding of what's almost the common man on the street understands. So it's very important that we're reaching everyone in this message. The second book, Gay Children, Straight Parents, is our de facto book for our parent support circle. So you can imagine the influence Richard has on the work that we're doing. It's our de facto book for the support circle. The other book, which perhaps doesn't get maybe as much attention, is actually, it contains a brief history of the movement, of the gay movement, the meaning behind SSA. It goes into why some certain celebrities are experiencing SSA. and using the right terminology, so words that are offensive and words that are healing, and how to approach men or women who have same-sex attraction using the right terminology. So again, a very, very useful resource. Now, I love time, touch, and talk, because like I told you, it was simple, straightforward. When you get this book, at the start of each of the chapters, you can go, right, I want to go family healing. Right, this is the section which I want to go, right? So you can dip in and out of the book. It's really practical. For this population, and the reason why I focused on touch is because a lot of us have issues around touch, and hopefully we can go into that a bit more. But yeah, it is, like you say, you can go at the start of the chapter, you can see exactly where you're going for self-healing, or if you're going for family healing or community healing. All of those three are covered in time, touch, and talk. And I really like this way of the sunlight being time, and the air being talk, and the water being the touch, and that as we're growing from, you know, as we're experiencing growth, that these are constants, right? These are constants which are there. And they're non-negotiable constants. It's not something that we can negotiate on. In terms of support, you know, in terms of, I really like this diagram as well, and it shows that really you want to take what fits for you and what doesn't fit. So different things will fit for different people. And it's important that you try different things. You know, you've got meditation, you've got visualization, you've got counseling, you've got volunteering, you know, just altruistic volunteering does huge wonders for the soul. And that's what I found in my work. Volunteering was a huge, huge saving force in the work which I did. Family, having the support from family or spiritual community, having support groups like we have or other groups. So there's a whole host of things which are, you know, there to build your support network. If you want to find more information, there is the main website is PATH. So that's pathinfo.org. And you can check out all the different resources which are there. And for the purposes of today, we're talking about Richard's latest book, Time, Touch, and Talk, which again, I think if you sign up, you can get a discount or something if you go on the website, which is really, really useful. So now, a lot of me babbling about things, and I know everyone's been waiting for this. So I hand over to Richard.
Well, thank you, Ali, for that humbling introduction. I am so grateful to be here today to share with you. I say good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. And we thank Allah for this amazing technology to bring us all together. Thank you to this wonderful group and the work that you do, Ali. I commend you. And I know it's a labor of love, as you were saying about me getting into this work. It was a calling. 100%, it was a calling I never imagined. And I've been a psychotherapist almost 34 years now. And well, I won't repeat what Ali said. Today's focus is on the new book, Healing Humanity, Time, Touch, and Talk. This is a blueprint for the healing of everyone. So as Ali was saying, my previous books dealt with same-sex attraction. This book is for everyone. And we all need lots of healthy touch in the bosom of our family, our community, and the world. Healthy touch heals. And it is so necessary for all of us. And what we experience in our home equals love to us, for better or for worse. And parenting, for those of you who are parents or those who will be parents, parenting is 95% show, 5% tell. It's not through our words that children learn. Monkey see, monkey do. They observe us and they will imitate. So the feelings that are not dealt with in the family, be it father, mother, or whoever the caregivers are, if they don't deal with it, it gets pushed to the children. And feelings buried alive never die. And time doesn't heal anything. It just stuffs our issues. And we bring our good and bad experiences into all of our personal and professional relationships. Excuse me. So if there was fighting in the family, now parents are in the position of Mr. and Mrs. God. It's the visible manifestation of Allah's masculine and feminine nature. So when we see Mr. and Mrs. God fighting, it creates the world doesn't make sense for a child. And just to let you know, neglect by parents is equally devastating to children. It doesn't have to look so traumatic. Neglect, a parent there and not there, or leaving, that's also extremely hurtful. If the parents split up, Mr. and Mrs. God, again, it's the world doesn't make sense. Hurting people hurt people. Healthy people help people. And whatever issue or issues you're dealing with that you haven't dealt with from your past, what you resist persists. So we're going to go into the time section first. And as Ali was saying, it represents sunlight. This is getting in touch with your soul to heal the wounds of your past and fulfill your legitimate unmet needs for love. No one will respect you if you don't respect yourself. Self-love works its way out. And also, if we have low self-worth, that creates pain pollution in the world. It gets projected onto others. For those who have read my previous books, they know, you know about the 10 potential causes of wounding. Again, this is globalized to include everyone. And the 10 causes, now I could speak hours about this. I'm just going to very briefly say heredity are inherited issues. We've seen in the scientific literature, psychological literature, that in family systems, issues don't dissolve or disappear, even though you're a believer in Allah. Still, whether there's been abuse or addictions or misuse of money, these issues continue. We inherit both the good and the bad of our families. Temperament, this is innate. We're born with beautiful gifts. We know for those who experience unwanted same-sex attraction, most, if not all, are hypersensitive, which is beautiful. However, if the environment doesn't support that gifting of one's sensitivity, it can be extremely punishing within the family and in the peer groups and in the greater community. There's many other temperaments. Heteroemotional wounding, that's mother, son, father, daughter. Again, I could speak hours about this. I'm just breezing through it. Homoemotional wounds, father, son, mother, daughter. And it could be enmeshment, which is the mother shares for the heteroemotional, she shares too much about her issues with her son, which is inappropriate because it makes him a parentified child. Too much, too soon, the knowledge. The father can do the same with his daughter. And then homoemotional is we see a lot of dads and sons don't bond well, don't get connected, and the mother daughters. Family dynamic sibling wounds don't fit in, could be bullying. Okay, I'm not going to go into this much more. It's too many things. Body image wounds, sexual abuse, high percentage of the population all over the world. And those issues don't go away. They must be dealt with. Social peer wounds, cultural wounds, and other factors. So my suggestion is you go through this list, which is in the book, and write down what are the wounds that you experienced in your early childhood and adolescence, or pre-adolescence through adolescence. Because the issues that don't get reconciled, they're always there. And if we don't deal with them, we're passing them on to our children and the next generations. So unless you make peace with your parents and or caregivers, whether they're living or passed away, you can never leave home because they live inside of us. This comes from Dr. Margaret Mahler and others who call it introjection. We internalize parents, authority figures, even cultural images. And those issues from our past, again, time doesn't heal anything. Why do we do what we don't want to do? Two things mainly: unhealed wounds from our past and legitimate unmet needs for love. Again, parents are in the position of Mr. and Mrs. God. And if we did not successfully internalize that love after puberty, well, I'm going to explain that in a moment. So these two things, the hurts in the heart that haven't healed and the needs for love, drive all unwanted behaviors: compulsive masturbation, using porn, affairs, sexual infidelity, numerous addictions. In the Healing Humanity book, Time, Touch, and Talk. By the way, all the books that Ali mentioned in the beginning are available on Amazon or Barnes & Noble or iTunes, except the Straight Talk book. That's not available there. You can get it off our website. However, all the other books are available on Amazon or Barnes & Noble or iTunes. So, five stages of healing. Behavioral, the support network that Ali showed in the beginning. Cognitive, that's the mind, affirmations, and developing one's self-worth, self-esteem. Healing the heart, inner child work, and relationships, first opposite sex, and then same-sex wounds. For the general population, I reverse the order of healing with the last two categories. So healing the mind, I really recommend this book, 10 Days to Self-Esteem by Dr. David Burns. It is a workbook. I like books. You don't just read it, you do it. So if you just read, it's great information. However, it needs to be, we need, you know, nerve cells that fire together, wire together. Nerve cells that fire apart, wires depart. Neurologically, we know that we can change through the study of neuroplasticity. So practicing these skills can change your negative thinking about yourself and others to positive, rational, wonderful thinking. Affirmations. In the book, I suggest you write a list of things you wish your dad and your mom and perhaps peers would have said to you while you were growing up, and things you wish they had done. And then you make a recording with beautiful music in the background. And I guarantee you, money back guarantee, but you didn't pay for the seminar. Anyway, affirmations, if you use them on a regular basis, it will change how you think and feel about yourself and then others. So everyone, I just want you to experience a little what I mean of the affirmation. So please close your eyes for a moment. And as you relax, imagine that Allah is speaking to you. I love you. I love you just the way you are. I am so proud of you. I am holding you in my arms. I will always be here for you. I love you. I love you. I love you. And feel free once again to open your eyes. So that was just a little taste of affirmations. And if you use these for minimum 4 months daily, I suggest once in the morning and once in the evening. Now, I always say succeed small rather than fail big. You know, someone goes on a diet and then you break it and then, oh, forget it. And then you just keep eating. So do simple things. So with the affirmations, after you make the recording or have others make it for you, use it 2 to 3 times a week. Succeed, then after 4 weeks, do 5 to 6 times a week. You keep building up the dosage until you do it once in the morning and once at night. When you do this, and the recordings are just like 5 minutes long, it will change you. Again, it's so powerful. Now we're going to talk about inner child. So I want you to watch a cute little video about each one of our inner children.
A man wants to wipe for his face. A man wants a place in the sun. A man wants a gal proud to say that she'll become his loving wife. He wants a chance to give his kids a better life. Well, hello. Travel all around the world.
So and back.
You can fly or sail or ride a railroad track. But no matter where you go, you're gonna find have the same things on their mind. A man wants to work for his pay. A man wants a place in the sun. A man wants a gal proud to say that she'll become loving wife. He wants a chance to give his kids a better life. Well, hello, brother.
Well, I just wanted you to see that. We all have a little boy, little girl inside of us, whether you're 80 years old or whether you're eight. Well, the eight-year-old is still the child. And we all need to get in tune and in touch with the little boy or little girl that we were while growing up. This is one of the most expeditious ways to heal your heart. And I love this book, Recovery of Your Inner Child by Dr. Lucia Cappuccione. This is a workbook. You need a sketch pad and crayons and coloring pencils. Over the last 25 years, I've done all these exercises 8 times as I've taught the book, and every other year I love to do it. This is some of my homework when I was writing this book. I drew triple D. My inner child said, get the damn thing done already. I'm sick of it. And there's, you know, you do writing and you do drawing. This is when I was typing it again. And I lots of coloring. So this is your homework. I suggest 1 chapter every 2 weeks. So you really internalize what she's teaching about your angry child, your vulnerable child, and then your inner parents, your protector, your nurturer, and deal with the critical parent, all those negative voices in our head. And it's not a matter of getting rid of them. It's a matter of understanding and actually embracing your inner critic. If you don't, adult efforts will be sabotaged by your inner child and your inner critic. We are so oversexed in the world because we are undernourished. As I was planning for today, I looked at who uses porn the most in the world. The number one country is, what do you think? US, UK, Pakistan.
I knew it.
The second country that uses porn the most is Egypt. Yeah. So, in case you don't think it's in the Arab community, think again. So the touch section is like water for relationships. Without water, a plant will die, or we die. Touch is the most important of our 5 senses. We can live without sight, sound, smell, and speaking. But an infant and a child cannot survive without touch. And as adolescents and adults, we cannot thrive without healthy touch. It is so important. Lack of healthy touch creates a biochemical imbalance in the body, increases masturbation, potential violence, and may lead to addictive behaviors. That's unhealthy touch or lack of touch. By experiencing healthy touch by our parents, relatives, caregivers, we internalize a sense of secure connection, bonding, attachment. If it doesn't occur in the early stages of development, we may easily sexualize those legitimate bonding needs. I've prepared 2 little animations. The first one is about SSA. The second one is about OSA, opposite sex attraction. This is a very broad generalization. Sorry, technological issue. Oh yeah, that's right. I'm doing right. So this is, I'm sorry, this is the opposite sex. I don't mean to denigrate dads. It's just I'm using this one example. So here we see in the scene a dad is there but not there, or perhaps he's working all the time, perhaps he's on missions, or perhaps they split up. So you can see how upset, angry the mother is. Now, if the father isn't there to help with the parenting, the mother has to become both Mr. and Mrs. God. So she loses the beauty of her femininity and just becomes more, and maybe she has to support the family. So the son is not only lost dad, he's lost mom, the feminine. Then he grows up and becomes a teenager, and he looks very handsome guy. Still inside of him is that wounded inner child. So when he becomes an adult, the need for having mother's love becomes sexualized through puberty, and he goes after women and perhaps has multiple affairs. Inside of him is that little boy. He can be a good Muslim, a good Christian, or Catholic, or Protestant, or Hindu. It doesn't matter. Still, his needs for that healthy love, feminine love, is now sexualized. Same will hold true. Again, apologies to the men. So the guy's walking out, the mother is sad, and the girl lost her Mr. Dad. And she becomes a beautiful woman. She's going to use her body to get the attention, affection, and affirmation from men and give her body away for it. This is happening all over the world, the sexualization of bonding needs. This is about SSA. Two guys attracted to each other. Going into the past, the one guy is close to mom. Dad is distant, attached. He's close to his sister also. The boys at school are bullies and call him names. He's closer to the girls. So all that feminine and no masculine. The little boy is hurt inside of him. So he's looking to get those needs met through other men. And it won't work because both of them are looking for the same thing that neither one of them has experienced, which is why this big social experiment of homosexual marriage, we know heterosexual marriages are horribly dysfunctional as well. We're going to see a lot more divorces with homosexual marriages. Only healthy touch will heal our mind and heart and satiate our bodily hunger for secure attachment, connection. Just a few porn stats, sexual infidelity meds. Now, I'm in the USA, so I looked up those. Over 4 million Americans regularly view porn sites. Worldwide, $100 billion. Annual revenue. Can you imagine? In the US, 50% divorce rate. In the UK, it's about 40%. Sexual infidelity, 33 to 75% of men, 26 to 70% of women. Just for the church people, 68% of church-going men and over 50% of pastors view porn regularly. And this one is heartbreaking. 11 years old is the average age that a child will first view porn. And 94% of all children, that's almost 100%, will see porn by the age of 14. That is sexual abuse of the mind of a child. America accounts for 5% of the world's population and uses 80% of the global supply of opioids. Why? Because we're in more pain? No, because we're great at medicating our pain. Porn feels great. It releases dopamine, it's emotional high. norepinephrine, creating alertness and focus, oxytocin, binding our brain to porn images, endorphins, natural high, and serotonin, calm and relaxed after sexual release. Porn reduces a person's ability to experience gratification with their own partner. And the brain gets tattooed with porn images. The brain bonds to porn, not people. And for those in the faith community, it intensifies guilt and shame. You can view a great TED talk by Dr. Gary Wilson about porn. You can go to his website, yourbrainonporn.com, or you can go to TED Talk and put in Dr. Gary Wilson about porn. Great talk. Touch does not equal sex. The world is saying this horrible lie that touching equals sex. It is not true. We must experience healthy touch. It stimulates all the bodily systems. And Dr. Virginia Satir, a great therapist, said, we need 4 hugs a day for survival, 8 hugs a day for maintenance, and 12 hugs for growth. Every day, 4 just to survive. We're so undernourished. Healthy hug is one arm. Oh, this is my Time Touch and Talk t-shirt, by the way. You can't see. Yay, Time Touch and Talk, triple T. So healthy hugs are one arm above the shoulder, one arm below, not 2 arms coming up or 2 arms like that. Healthy hugs look like this. Unhealthy hugs, the A-frame, when you're both, looks like a church, you know, both sticking their butts out, the duck hug, like that, and then side saddle when the pelvic areas don't touch. These are not healthy hugs. Ah, doesn't that look delicious? Healthy hugs heal. Now, this is my wife holding our daughter, and this is me holding our oldest son. As many, like Ali, have read my other books, I put positions of holding. And over the years, when I was doing therapy, I no longer do it, I would hold my clients when they needed to grieve and grieve. And it was very healing. Then I would teach them, bring your mentors in and I'll teach them. That's better for them. And this is holding our youngest son. Wow, he's now like a bodybuilder this tall. This was, well, I don't know, 14 years ago. He's a tall, big dude now. So these are different types of healthy touch and holding. And if you didn't get this growing up, for me, it was life and death. And without getting this in my healing process, I would be dead today, like my former boyfriend who died of HIV/AIDS-related diseases. And just a warning, when you first get your needs met, it may create pain because your inner child feels, why now? Why not then, when I needed it or needed you? So if you have a safe person that you can experience healthy touch with, you can let them know you're going through lots of pain and let it out. That's the natural process of healing, is grieving. And we get it out, and then we can really receive the love. The more you're real and the more you feel, the quicker you will heal. If you're working with a therapist who's just talk, fire her or fire him. You're wasting your time and money. You need a whole synthesis, many different approaches to heal the head, the heart, the body, and spirit. With high tech, we're all on our devices all the time. We need more touch. So if you're not getting it, get out and find safe, healthy people. Love is the medicine that heals all pain. Finally, the talk section. Talk is oxygen for personal and professional relationships. Without oxygen, again, we suffocate and die. So we need to learn effective listening and sharing skills, which I'll share a few in a moment. We have two of these and one of these. So we need to be listening twice as much as we speak. Now that's a challenge for many of us. So listen, and listening isn't just keeping your mouth shut. I'll share some good listening skills in a moment. Listening is much more difficult than sharing. Honor differences. And without sharing your thoughts, feelings, and your needs in close relationships, you'll never achieve real love and intimacy. And blessed are the flexible, for they shall not be bent out of shape. Hard to achieve. Effective, these are a few listening skills. First is maintain eye contact. Even if the other person's looking up or looking down, looking away, still maintain eye contact because they can sense if you're really trying to connect with her or him. Second, join. Your mind may be racing. Oh, I can't stand what she's saying. I think he's full of it. You know, just try to join. Stand in her shoes. The more you do, the calmer your mind will become. And third, research has shown more powerful than words is body language and the tone. So for example, I love you, or I love you. The first one, I'm really saying, you know, screw you. The second one is, I really love you. So watch for body language and tone. That says so much. This is reflective listening, which takes a lot of practice and work. And I promise, if you practice this with people who are close to you, it will bring such a greater sense of caring, sharing, understanding, and love. So the first is paraphrase. So for example, she comes home from work and she's worked hard all day, and then her husband says, oh, I had a horrible day and I took care of this. And she like wants to, you know, strangle him because she needs to be heard. And instead, she says, oh, so you've had a difficult day, did you? Yes, I did, he says. And she says, is there more? He said, yeah. And then he goes on and on. And she continues to paraphrase, well, you know, your boss was a blank and you're this and that. And she paraphrases. And she says, is there more? He said, no, that's it. And then she summarizes everything he just said. See, listening is work. And now, if you forget something, he might say, well, you said it all, but you forgot blank, blank. Then she repeats that. Is there more, dear? No, you got it. Then she said, well, given that, I imagine you must think. Now, this is the most difficult. Feeling empathy is easy. Thought empathy, you have to really get into his mind, make a hypothesis, how you think he's thinking. And in the beginning, you may get this wrong a lot, which is fine, he'll correct you. So I imagine that you must think your boss is very demanding. He doesn't appreciate the hard work you're doing. And you work so hard. Is that it? You got it. And then after that, you go to feeling empathy. I imagine you must feel frustrated, angry, upset, and tired. Is that it? You're right. And I also feel blank, blank. And then he said, and then you repeat it. That's reflective listening. Now, after you do that, you can say, well, would you like any feedback from me? And he can say yes, or he can say no. And if he says no, that's it, done. Unless you want to share about your day then and say, dear, would you listen to me? And then if he says no, you have to go call a friend, or you go into the bedroom and say, excuse me, I got to go take care of myself. And you scream, or you talk to God or whatever. So this is reflective listening. It works if you practice it. And you can do this at work with your boss, with your coworkers. It's very effective. A few more skills for sharing. What? Reflective listening. Oops. These are, wrong word, should be listening skills, a few more. Say the magic words. Thank you, person's name, tell me more. If you can't do the paraphrasing, thought and feeling empathy, just thank you, Ali, tell me more. And then he goes on. Now you may think people will, wow, that's patronizing. No, 95% of people will love to just talk and be heard. Second is Kim's. Now Korean, keep your mouth shut, which means if you're too upset when you're listening to somebody, just zip it and just keep your mouth shut. And then silence. If somebody's sharing and then he stops, don't fill the empty space right away. Just maybe he's going deeper and then he'll share more. Now, if the silence is there for a while and then the person who's speaking says, well, why aren't you saying anything? You can say, well, I was just waiting to see if you had any more to share, which is the truth. And finally, if you're wearing a watch or using your phone, whatever, don't look at your watch when someone is sharing with you, because it sends a message that you want them to close up and finish. You can only look at your watch or the time when you are sharing. Very simple skill. Now, these are sharing skills. Use I statements. I think, I feel, I believe. Not you. I takes responsibility. You is accusing and blaming. Establish, keep the eye contact, physical touch in appropriate relationships. This is a conflict resolution protocol. It's great. It's from Dr. Marshall Rosenberg's Nonviolent Communication and Mankind Project. I kind of put their two protocols together. Because of time, I'm not going to go into detail about it. You can read about it in the book. Really works beautifully. Temperament, character, personality. Temperament is innate. It's our biology, the gifts we're born with. Character, learned behavior as we grow up within our family, within our community, and in the culture. And personality is a combination of our temperament and our character. And as I was saying earlier, we can change at any time in our life, our thinking, our feelings, how we express ourselves, our behaviors, through lots of practice and practice and practice. So everything I've told you about takes months and months and months of practice. And again, through the science of neuroplasticity, we know the brain and body neurologically changes. Change is always possible. Hippocrates from Greece talked about four temperaments. I'm not going to go into them. There are many amazing personality paradigms, Myers-Briggs, Enneagram, Helen Fisher's work, Gary Chapman, birth order. I just got a new book, Five Personality Patterns. There's so much great literature there describing our different personalities. And the power of this knowledge is that I can understand myself, and then I can understand my partner and my children, or many businesses or places of faith use the Myers-Briggs or Enneagram, so that people can understand each other better, and then there's more peace. So these are great personnel, and I have all the websites in the book too, where you just look them up. Touch and talk is a healing trinity. Time, life-changing exercises for personal, family, community healing. Touch, simple solutions to separate love, sex, and intimacy through the power of healthy touch. And talk, effective listening, remember twice as much, then sharing. We all need healthy touch. It's one of my greatest passions in this life. We need it in our family and we need it in our community. And the more healthy touch, the more healed and helping and loving we'll all become. Everything I've shared is just a brief summary of the new book, Healing Humanity, Time, Touch and Talk. We have our website, timetouchandtalk.com. And thank you very much.
Wow. Thank you, Richard, for that amazing talk. And as you can see, audio, visual, very, very much interactive, and I love that. And I love the fact that the book recommendations are even more things that we can interact with, that we can actually apply and learn. And the learning never stops, right?
Never. I'll be 70 this year, and I'm still growing up.
Amazing. So I'd love to go to the Q&A part. Unless Richard wants to share something before we go. Okay, brilliant. So now's the time that you've all been waiting for, obviously.
I'm sorry, Ali, may I share? There is one thing. Let's see if I can open. If anybody is in the, we call it the DMV, Washington, D.C., Maryland, Virginia area. Yeah. I'm doing a Time, Touch, and Talk one-day healing seminar on April the 30th. And you can read more information about it on the Time, Touch, and Talk website. So this is the flyer for the healing seminar. So it's a one-day healing in-person seminar. It's not going to be online. It's very confidential for inner child exercises and healing, affirmations, resolving relationship issues, and healthy touch. So just if anyone's interested, it's on our Time, Touch, and Talk website. Okay, I'll be quiet. I want to hear your questions.
No, that's amazing. And it's so much things which in this work needs to be experiential, you know.
Yeah.
So and seminars like this don't come by, you know, they're really, really rare. So I encourage people who are in the vicinity to please.
Thank you.
And it looks like a very, very discounted price, I'd say.
Yeah, I made it very cheap, right? So and it includes lunch and refreshments, so everybody can come.
That's amazing. I'm sure many people will definitely benefit from that. So in terms of Q&A, just be aware that this is streamed live on Facebook. So if you want to be anonymous, the best way to do is to use the Q&A function, which you can already see at the bottom of the screen. There's Q&A. You can, as some of you have already started, you can write anonymously. And then people who don't have questions or are curious of what other people are writing, you can use the like button so you can upvote the ones that you would like to be answered first. But if you want to ask a question, just be where your name will then come on, you can raise your hand and we can start with our questions. Please, I would encourage you to keep the questions to the material that was presented in this session.
I can see them, Ali. Should we just start at the beginning, or how do you want to deal with this?
Okay, I'll see if anybody wants an audio question, if you want to raise your hand, if it's not something which is already in the Q&A. But if not, we can start as so. I can see the first one, which is saying, Richard, please let me know how to deal with extremely low self-esteem issues, which ultimately leads to SSA and other destructive behaviors.
Hmm. Well, low self-esteem does not just lead to SSA. There are so many people in the world who do not experience same-sex attraction and also have low self-esteem. And okay, so how to deal with that? Again, this is a great
that's what I was gonna
say. Great start. Use this one chapter every 2 weeks. His main tool is called the daily mood log, to identify what happened, how you feel about it, and then identifying your thoughts. And then I'm not going to go into the whole technique. That's one. Second is using the affirmations. Write the list down of things you wish dad and or mom and peers would have said and done with you while growing up. And have people record, people that can speak lovingly. Let me see if I can. So last year I taught a group of Coptic Christian therapists in Egypt. I did it online. I did my 5-day counselor training and I had them do it. And I said, well, I want to do it too. So I had my translator, she was my mother voice, and this other guy who was a tech guy. So here's some.
My precious son.
Can you hear?
Yeah, yes.
Richard, I love you with all of my heart.
So that was my dad.
I'm so proud of who you are as a powerful man of God.
I called him Scotland because he spoke with a Scottish accent. And then.
You are such a sensitive soul.
This is my mother's voice.
I will always love you just the way you are.
So you have people record these for you and you put beautiful music in the background and then you put it together and listen. Again, ideally morning and night. Now, when you start doing it, first you're going to say, wow, that's wonderful, or it feels great. It's like bathing in a bathtub of love. After, though, your heart, your inner child may say, screw you, and get angry because you didn't hear that while growing up. Put it on pause, let it out. Then press play again and continue. Whenever you feel hurt, upset, angry, let it out. If you do this, I did it when I was in my initial therapy for 1 year. It changed how my sense of self-worth and self-esteem, because I hated myself for so many reasons, SSA and all kinds of, you know, I was a phony. I had so many masks on that I developed through childhood. And so this is one way, you know, through the 10 days to self-esteem, or mind over mood is another great resource. It's in Arabic. Unfortunately, 10 days to self-esteem is not, it's in English. And then the affirmation. So that's a few ways to begin. I'm sorry, I speak too much.
No, fantastic. And as Richard mentioned, because we have psychotherapist which join us as well, and that he has the counselor training program, which I have, which is again really, really useful, and offers a practical way to deal with clients with practical solutions like the affirmation recording, which Richard is discussing. So no, thank you for that. The other question is, what should I do if I'm drawn too much about the size of male genital, which is causing me a lot of depression, and same-sex experiences through eyes, given the fact I know I'm fairly above average in that department?
I love it. Well, if I was your therapist, I would do a few exercises for body image shame and guilt and healing. And I would let your penis talk, because obviously there's shame. Because you said you're above average, but that doesn't even matter whether you have a average, or it doesn't matter. Size doesn't matter. Actually, for a woman, when having sex, a smaller penis is better to stimulate her clitoris, but that's another whole discussion. Okay, the truth is in your genitals. It's not in your head, it's in your body. And there must be shame in that area. Perhaps when you were growing up, somebody said, oh, you know, cousins or whomever put shame into your genitals. And now you look at men's penises, which is a metaphor, by the way. Even if you want to have oral or anal sex, it's not about the sex act. All that is a metaphor. I want his genitals because I don't feel and experience masculine enough, or I don't behave masculine enough. So don't worry about the size. I would let your penis talk and hear what he has to say. And in any of the books, well, the Being Gay book or the Time, Touch, and Talk book, there's exercises how to do this.
Yes, absolutely. There is Time, Touch, and Talk. There is a section on this, this very topic. So I definitely can benefit.
Thanks for your question.
Thank you for the very honest and vulnerable question there. How to manage the anxiety and irrational fears caused due to SSA?
SSA is not about SSA. Now, I know in the Muslim or Catholic or Christian community, there's lots of guilt and shame placed upon a person who experiences SSA. And that's really sad. It's almost like scapegoating people. You know, you're the lowest one. You're the worst one. It's not true at all. That's not how Allah feels about us. So again, I would have you have you embrace your inner homo. Talk, I would listen to the part of you that feels like I'm gay or I'm lesbian or I'm whatever, because the issue is not about that. SSA has nothing to do with SSA. Again, it's about hurts in the heart that haven't healed and legitimate needs for love. And when we resolve the hurts and the stinking thinking, and when we get the right kinds of love, SSA will no longer have a purpose. It's just a message from your soul trying to get your attention. Don't try to get rid of it. That's not the point of healing.
Love that, yeah. Let it feel it and not let it be something which is irrational. Thank you. It seems quite difficult to practice such activities when the same sex attraction is so intense. A lot of time touching the skin of another man leads to sexual desires and further frustration. How do we move past this?
Yeah, great question. I'll just use myself as an example, and I've seen it with all the clients I worked with. When I was getting healthy touch from three heterosexual men, and I just want to say, these men do not grow on trees. It took me so much failure looking for the right type of guy. I was rejected. It's like in sales. People who are sales, men or women, know, like, expect 9 rejections before you get 1 sale. And it was like this. I kept going after so many different guys, and I was rejected before I found one. And it took a long time. So when I found a guy, and I say in the book, ideally 3 healthy male mentors for the men, 3 healthy female mentors for the woman dealing with unwanted SSA. So when I found, and if you can heal with your own parent, like your dad, for a guy, that's ideal. If he's willing and capable, if he's abusive or incapable or he's past, find others, grandfather, uncles, people in the community, your faith community. So when you finally get what you want, you may experience pain and, like you said, sexual arousal. I did right away. I was so afraid to hug people, whether they be men or women. Excuse me, because I was sexually abused at the age of 5 for 1 year by my American football playing uncle. He was a pro in the pro National Football League. And so my wires got all meshed. Sex and touch were all like this. So when men would hug me or I would hug men, I instantaneously got an erection. So in my healing with these men that helped me, I got aroused immediately and they were safe people. So I explained, they knew I was in therapy. I'm going through a lot inside and I'm sexually aroused. And for all three of them, they're all heterosexual guys. I had to say, my inner child needed to say, would you like me to surface you? Meaning, would you like a blowjob or, you know, whatever? I had to say that to them. And I needed to hear them say no. And to each one of their credit, they said, no, Richard, I don't need that from you. When I heard the no, I cried and cried and cried. And I work with so many in therapy who had to share that type of thought with their mentors when they were experiencing healthy touch, both guys with the male mentors, women with the female mentors. It's humiliating. It's not easy. And it's the only way through to healing. Feel and be real in order to heal.
Thank you for that share, and so powerful what you just said in terms of the rewiring, which happens very earlier for a lot of us in childhood. And but I always, you know, we always tell people that there's neuroplasticity. We can create different outcomes for this. And at first, it is very, very difficult to ask for what we really, really want, right? And I think, even for myself, when in the work, it's taking that risk. Mm-hmm. And that risk does pay off when you get that support network and you get a support network which allows healthy touch. I always mention we had this boy at school who would just stand in the middle of the class with his hands like that and say, hug me. And everybody would just go and hug him. And I used to look at him and I say, I can't do that. He's so confident. I really want a hug, but I couldn't do it. And part of it was just me feeling a lot of shame that I had that need, and working through the difficult thoughts, like you're saying, in that fearing an erection and so on. And I think, as you've said before, when we make same-sex attraction a reality and we no longer run from it and we realize that these are legitimate desires that need to be addressed and we're not running away from them anymore, that's when we get the courage to be vulnerable and to take that risk. So thank you for sharing that. How do you respond to those who say change of sexuality through all this work is temporary and the vast majority don't experience permanent change, only a tiny minority?
May I make a request?
Sure, yes. Yeah,
because time is limited.
Do you want to take the questions?
No, let me just, I'm going to read them all quickly and see if I can put some of them together.
Over to you.
Thank you. Regarding personalities, do you believe personalities can change over time through conscious effort or otherwise? If sometimes has a neurotic, anxious personality, or if someone does, it's very difficult to practice these things. Yeah. Thank you so much for your thank you. You said you cannot move on until we make peace with our parents. could you kindly elaborate? Oops. Now everybody's sending bazillions of questions in. Thank you for your, could you kindly elaborate? Oh, don't remove the questions yet, Ali. My mind will not retain it all. Please leave it there. Thank you. About making peace with your parents. Thanks. What was that first one I read?
So, you removed regarding personality.
Oh, personality. Got it. Yeah. Change it. How do you respond to those who say change of sexuality is only temporary and for the majority it doesn't work? Are you thinking about doing any online healing sessions for parents with children who struggle with SSA? Been there, done that. No. I did it for years. You can email me through the Path Info website or Time Touch and Talk website, and I'll connect you to therapists who, one in Spain that I've trained, they're doing a parent support group, so in Espanol. In Egypt, there's Dr. Shiabeldin Hawadi. He's my son. I trained and mentored him for many years. If he's not leading parents group, he's created therapists who do. That's in Arabic. Good afternoon. I'm looking for their 16-year-old daughter. Email us through the pathinfo.org website. In the chat, I'll put the email address after this, because I have referral therapists that I've trained. I've met dozens of people who've gone through years of reparative therapy. However, only one of them has claimed they've changed. That sucks. Others have said it's helped in other matters, except, you know, not change their orientation. Why is this common? I wanted to respond to this one before moving on. Mm-hmm. You know, one guy came to me, he was in the military, tall, big, handsome dude. And he said, I want to change, but I don't want to get rid of my SSA. I said, I don't want you to either. Relax, embrace him. He's been your best friend for your whole life. So it's not a matter of getting rid of SSA. So people who have done so many types of therapies, they didn't feel to heal. You've got to be real, like Ali was saying about asking for your needs. It's not easy unless we learn to express our needs, and many people will not understand, and you're going to have to learn to accept rejection. That's about the other person. It's not about you. So people who say they, quote unquote, haven't changed, they haven't healed. And heal, like the byproduct of healing is the resolution of unwanted SSA. My clients went through it. Their stories are in the Being Gay book. Of course, there's many others. And they heal at the core, not just cognitive behavioral therapy. Can you please do an online workshop on Triple T? Okay. I'll think about that. That will be interesting. Why do you think there aren't many therapists entering this field and most of them charge, $200 to $350 a session? That's a travesty. Mm-hmm. It's greatly burdensome. Yeah, well, contact me. I'll send you to the guy that I trained, and he charges half of that. And he's wonder. He was one of my three mentors who helped save my life. Great man, loving man. Anyway, he does therapy. Okay. I'm going to forget those other questions. So the personality, about the anxiety, and I forget the second, what was it? Anxiety and what? Do you remember?
The personality is one.
Yeah, the first one. Because they're they're up there. Oh no, that one's not.
Do you believe personalities can change over time through conscious effort? Sometimes in neurotic, yes. Anxious personality.
The answer is absolutely, and it's going to take a lot of work. And I suggest if somebody is really anxious or neurotic about things, first you may need medication just to calm down the physiology temporarily. And then good therapy will address, you know, cognitive behavioral changes so you can start to feel better and more calm, and meditation, visualization exercises, and then we'll deal with the heart. So absolutely, it's not easy. It just takes the right type of therapist and the right type of approaches. 16-year-old daughter, not change. Can you please do online triple C seminar? Yet too expensive? Well, again, contact us for more effective and not that expensive. How to help the 16-year-old daughter thinking she might have SSA. Mother, bond with your daughter. Mother, bond with your daughter. Father, take two steps back. Over the 34 years of doing this work, if the son has SSA, who usually calls our office for help, the mother or the father? Huh?
The mother.
99% of the time, if the son has SSA, the mother calls. Now, if the daughter has SSA, well, who calls for help?
The father.
99% of the time, the father calls. When the same-sex parent calls, I think, wow, good prognosis. So read, as Ollie was saying in the beginning, the Gay Children, Straight Parents book. It's not a book to read. It's a book to do. So if you read and think, wow, that's great. Okay, start again and do all the exercises and activities. Heal thyself. There's a wonderful couple that I worked with years ago, and I did a family healing session for them. I still do the family healing sessions. It's a two-day experience for the father, mother, and all the children, regardless of their ages. And they came with their son. Both of them were pastors. And the son had just come out, junior in high school. And I'll never forget, I wish I had it on film. The first day was 10 hours, usually it's 8 hours, but just one child. They were, I mean, there was like fireworks, and there was so much healing. And the father, who was very stoic, you know, didn't show emotions. As soon as it was his time with his son, there's a, you know, this is not a talk, just sit and talk thing. This is experiential. This is getting your stuff out. Well, the father shared. I had the father share before the son shares with him. And the father just drenched his son with tears. And the son had never seen his father cry in his life. And his father apologized for being such a detached, distant man. And it broke his son's heart. His son was, you know, the son got so much crap out with his mom. And he was ready to throw, you know, thunderbolts to his dad, but his dad broke his heart. It was unbelievable. And then I had the father hold, you know, the holding position I showed you. And I said, you're going to practice this now 3 to 5 times a week. And the parents jumped in. The point is this, they did the 10 Days to Self-Esteem book, the parents, they did the Inner Child book. They did their own healing work. So parents, if you want your kids to change, lead by example. The parents who I've seen that are successful in helping their kids resolve SSA have changed themselves. And that changes all their relationships with their children. How do you deal with others in society, friends, etc., who openly come out as gay? A lot of the time, this causes a lot of confusion and pain for us because we believe it's a symptom and they believe it's an innate identity. Yeah, anyone 30 and younger today has been indoctrinated to homosexual ideology, innate, immutable, born this way and cannot change. The science does not support it. And I could quote you so many studies, even as early as 2019, there was a study of 500,000. They studied the DNA of so-called gay men and women. They gave permission to look at their genes. you know, that they had. Oh, anyway, this is Harvard and MIT researchers. And the study then said in Harvard Magazine and in Nature Magazine, no, still no gay gene. Anyway, the point is you cannot argue anybody out of this if they come out as gay, because they work so hard to come to peace with that. And in the Gay Children, Straight Parents book, I list 7 stages of coming out. So you can't talk anyone out of this. You have to win the heart, and then their head will follow. So don't say, well, I met a guy who used to be gay, and I'm married 42 years now with 3 adult kids. And you can just plant a seed, you know, wow, I heard this guy, it might be full of, this is the way to reverse psychology. I heard this guy who came out of homosexual, wait a minute, we're supposed to be talking about the Triple T book. I met this guy who came out of homosexuality. He's helped a lot of people come out of this. This is his book. Now, you're giving this to a gay person. Would you please look this over? It might be full of crap. You're the expert on homosexuality, not me. I don't know anything. So would you tell me if there's any validity to this, or it's just dung? It's pure crap. So you can plant a seed. You can't talk anyone out of it. And we're living in such a pluralistic, you know, we go on, you all know about that. Is there hope for someone who has a lot of sexual encounters with PPL? What's PPL? Do you know?
With people?
Yeah, maybe. I had done so much of that, I hardly think I could ever move on. Right now, I'm abstaining from sex. Does it mean I need to keep this? So is there hope for someone who's had a lot of sex? Absolutely. I was even a whore once. I wanted to see what that was like. So I was, that's how I met my boyfriend, actually. He answered my ad. He was an artist. Okay, Richard, shut up. I had done so much of that, I hardly think I could ever move on. You can. You can, you can, you can, you can, you can. You can, because it's not about sex or how much you have or haven't. You know, I have people who have had sex with 100 or hundreds, and I have people who never had sex. And in their mind, their struggle is the same. And the forces of the evil will tell you you can't, and you're no good, and it's not true. It's not true. You're beautiful. My favorite movie is The Color Purple. It's a Pulitzer Prize winning book by Alice Walker. And she was abused by her dad sexually, had 2 kids. And then this guy married her, and he just, you know, did his thing. That's what she said. He just jumps on me and does his business. And so this, what Shug Avery says to her, well, that means you're still a virgin. Even though she had sex with her dad and her husband just using her for years and years and years. And so I love you, and you can heal. And it's not about how much sex you did or didn't have. You need to be held in the arms of people who care about you. One guy who came to a healing seminar one time years ago, he was so physically abused by his father. If I told you what he went through, you'd all start crying. And during the holding exercise in the seminar, it's the first time in his life he had been held without somebody beating him or using him for having sex. Just through the holding, he spontaneously had an orgasm in his pants. And then he asked one of the co-facilitators, am I bad? Is it wrong? And the facilitator said, no, that's perfect. Your body, you know, you're an adult now. And that little boy and pre-adolescent didn't get what he needed. So of course, you know, in healing, we go in reverse. So we're going to experience a lot of sexual feelings with our mentors or people we're close with until we get to the core. That's why the more honest you are with a mentor about what you're experiencing, you know, a heterosexual mentor, the quicker you're going to heal. Love you, Richard. I love you too. You're a great inspiration. Thank you. If there were only one solution to get rid of SSA, would it be? You thinking that you have to get rid of it. That's the one solution.
I love that.
It's the wrong question. Please request Cohen to join a group, okay? Is there any, I mean that sincerely, because it's not about SSA. So many I've seen in the religious communities think, I got to get rid of it. I got to get rid of it. That's the answer. That's the goal. It's not. SSA is not about SSA. It's a symptom of what hurts and needs. Is there any genuine therapist available in India? If yes, please provide. I don't know, but that does not matter because we live in this technological age. And the last years when I was doing therapy, even before the internet, I did sessions on the phone. I took one guy from SSA to OSA. I never met the guy. And it was just, and I could do deep work over the phone. And then there's this. So even though you're in India or Pakistan, it doesn't matter. You can contact us and I'll give you some referrals. And, you know, when you meet the therapist, ask for a free 15-minute consult. And if she or he's not willing to do it, don't waste your time. You've got to meet them and make sure you have the right chemistry. And you ask them, what's your experience in this? Have you had success? And have you done your own healing work? Because most therapists, they're not worth their weight in a penny because they're still so wounded themselves. I'm not just talking about SSA, just in general. Your advice are incredibly helpful, Richard. So practical, not just theory. A to the men. Do you think of these activities can be practiced in our mosques? 100% hugging. Now I know men, you know, men, men, women, women, you're not allowed to touch the opposite sex. 1,000% teach your imam, right? Imam?
Imam, yes.
Imam. Give him a book and say, I'm sure like with a pastor or a priest, it's confidential. And say, I need men, you know, who will come alongside of me, give me healthy touch, etc. Now, don't get hooked on holding and hugging. That's just one piece of the healing process. But absolutely speak to your imam. That's, you know, the mosque, the temple, the synagogue, the church should be the safest place on the planet. If we only lived our faith, we would have the biggest one in the world. Do you think this generation is less likely to practice triple T? A lot of them are afraid of hugs. That's why God had me publish this book, baby. And triple T is just an idea now, but the real intention is to create triple T centers around the world. Just like Starbucks, we're going to have a triple T center every few streets. So rather than going online and looking at porn and masturbating or hooking up and having sex, you go to a triple T center and you'll say, I want to be held by a man. 15 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour. You pay, it will be very reasonable, and you get held. There will also be pounding pillows so you can beat the crap out of your boss or your partner or your parents, whatever. And once you get it out, then get held. So that's the vision, is triple T centers all over the world. Thank you so much. Oh, don't apologize for your slang. I curse every other word. I am so disciplining myself not to say cursing. Curse words. I've read triple T and you said isolation equals death, right? This is how I'm feeling right now. I kept myself for my entire life so far out of sex, a virgin, okay? Sometimes I feel this is killing me slowly. 32-year-old, what should I do? Failed to connect in groups. I'm in Egypt, Alexandria. God bless you. There are groups in Cairo, which is only a few hours away, Giza. So email me And I'll give you, you know, Dr. Shihab's contact information, and he can let you know about groups. So let me put in the chat. Let's see. So email address, that's my email. If you want a therapist, or you want to connect to a group in Egypt, you need it. You need it. Yeah, you deserve love. I hear you. It's like you've been killing yourself. Yeah, I get it. Especially for us in the faith community. It's so hard. It looks easier for those in the gay community. They can go and, you know, do it with anyone, anytime. So that's why we need to provide healthy touch. I hope I addressed all the questions. I thank you very much, Ali, for this opportunity to share with all you beautiful men and women around the world. I love you all.
We love you that you took the time for this webinar. And just to for people who are online and they didn't hear, it's R. Cohen. So R-C-O-H-E-N at pathinfo.org. So if you are listening and you're not YouTube or Facebook, you can get in touch with Richard. And I have to say, for this webinar, I was like saying, oh, I don't have a speaker for March. And I contacted Richard, and I thought Richard, really busy schedule and so on. But I can say, just for my communication with Richard, he's sincere. I don't know how he has the time, but he replies often, and he has a really, really big heart, and he's sincere in this work. And I really mean that, you know, and I really mean he is the pioneer in this work. And he has, so the recommendations that he is giving, that's through years of experience in working in this. So please don't take them lightly. And I've learned so much from the material, which is where, you know, there was nothing basically for this. And I think so grateful for the work. And I'm so happy that Time, Touch and Talk is now open for everyone, because, you know, sometimes, a lot of the times, the media or the group, they say, oh, you need a specific type of therapy for this specific same-sex attraction. And why I keep, you know, what we keep telling people is, well, no, this isn't, we aren't split by sexual identities, we're all the same. So when we're doing the work is all the same. If you have opposite sex attracted issues or same-sex attracted issues. So I think it's there's a universality to this message, which I think the TTT puts really, really well for everyone. So that's www.timetouchandtalk.com. And as we mentioned in our introduction, also www.pathinfo.org. I thank Richard for his time today, for the years of work which he's continuing to do. I thank God for today, for this opportunity for me to have Richard. Like I say, if there were any questions which you couldn't cover or you're too shy to ask, you can email me. You've got Richard's email, and we're here for any type of support. So I will leave any closing remarks for Richard if before we end.
Thank you, Ali. for your bravery to lead strong support for Muslim men, women, and parents. And now you're opening up wider, you know, about who are dealing with SSA. I commend you, and never, 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 ever, ever, never give up. There's always hope. There's always healing, and there is help. Don't stop. If you had therapists that it didn't work, find people who know how to help you. That's why I became a therapist. I never wanted to do this. And I did so much media, and people say, oh, why were you on so many shows? I never wanted to do it. I always would say, you do it. It's hell. And it was spiritual war. Mm. And I did this because Allah asked me to do it. So never give up. No matter how young or old you are, no matter what you're dealing with, there are answers. And when I was at the peak trying to get help, I was in New York City. And I went to this area in Central Park. And it was like a special place for me to pray. And I was crying and praying to God because I was just beginning the journey and I didn't have any books like I've written for a path. So I was praying and crying. And when I opened my eyes, it was, I had no idea. It was like the gay pickup area. And the most gorgeous man was standing there like, inviting me to have sex with him in the bushes or go to his place. And I was furious. I was furious. So I said, thank you, no thank you. And I started walking out and there were people around. You can see I'm a very expressive person. And I screamed at the top of my lungs and I said, God, Satan, get the F out of my way. I'm going to break through so you can help me or try to stop me. I don't give a crap. I'm going to do it with or without you. And I just screamed. So that was my determination. So never give up. Never give up. I'm a good therapist because I made every mistake possible. And as I said, I'm still a work in progress. So don't quit. No matter what anybody tells you, never give up. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Richard. We're all works in progress. Thank you for everyone for joining, and may Allah bless us all. Thank you.
Ciao, everybody. Take care. Yeah.